Good morning, everybody. Myself is Professor Dr. Rajendra Deshpande. We are in the Ayurved College, Nigdi, Pradhikaran, Pune 44. Today is a Wednesday, that is the 5th of September 2018. And today I am going to discuss a very interesting topic in our general medical practice. Whether you are practicing Ayurved, allopathy, or homeopathy, doesn't make any difference. Because personally, I believe that there should be proper differential diagnosis. Of course, when you want to be original Ayurvedic management, you can have some Ayurvedic concepts in your mind. But it doesn't mean that you should not know any modern type of the differential diagnosis, because sometimes it is get confused. Today I am going to discuss with you about differential diagnosis of fever, or the whatever in Ayurveda it is called as a jwara. So in Ayurveda also there are different types of jwara. For example, simple is a nija and agantuja types are there. Then when we talk about nija, then there is a vataja, pittaja, kafaja jwara, sannipatika jwara. Then vishama jwara is another category where you have the santata, satata, anyajyu, tritiyaka, chaturthaka. So in many different ways, and this is the actual part of the classification mentioned in the jwara topic by the charak. But if you are searching for the whole book, then you can find in many conditions jwara can be one of the symptom. So it may be the case of, for example, gulma or the arbuda, or it may be the grahani. There may be in pittaja grahani, there may be one symptom as a jwara. So in that aspect also you have to be kept all the things in your mind. But to avoid any bad consequences that we have not considered this point of modern medicine and we have lost the case, or the patient has landed into a serious trouble. As this should not happen, we should also simultaneously, every Ayurvedic doctor should also know the modern differential diagnosis of fever. So to begin with, within 5-10 minutes, I am just giving a very brief list of nearly 18 or 20 cases where you get the fever, different types of the fever. So what we will make as a type of like a trial or the test, that I am giving you the symptoms and you are expected to give me the diagnosis of the fever. So I am giving you the set of symptoms by which you should diagnose the cause of the fever. Okay, ready, start. So this is fever cases, especially with regards to the general medical practice. I am not dealing here the majority part of the hospital or the ICU cases, that I am not discussing. Or PUO, pyrex of unknown origin. It is also called as a FUO, fever of unknown origin. That I am not tackling right now. I am starting with very simple fundamental knowledge of fever. So the first patient, if you comes to you, before symptom I will say that nearly 90% cases of fever, as per the modern medicine language, they are called as viral fevers. 90% cases are viral fevers. And as there is no specific antiviral medicine available, they treat all viral cases symptomatically. Modern medicine physician, they always treat every case of the fever symptomatically, because antiviral drugs are not expected. And secondly, antibiotics don't have any role with the antiviral or as an antiviral. Virus is a different organism. Bacteria is a different organism. For example, I am talking about any bacterial infection, meningococcal meningitis. Then I have a very specific, very strong antibiotic. But when I am saying it is a viral fever, it is actually not expected to use the antibiotics. Ideally, it is not expected. Ethically, it is not expected. Of course, no doctor can wait for super added secondary bacterial infection, because many times it is possible that there is a secondary bacterial infection. What does it mean? Basic is a viral fever, but some bacteria has attacked because of the weakness, and that is called as a secondary bacterial infection. So what I mean to say, the first cause of any fever in general practice will be viral fever. Is it clear? And viral fever has no very specific systemic symptoms. Try to understand what I am saying. viral fever don't has any specific systemic symptom. For example, he doesn't have a green or yellow sputum regarding respiration. He don't have the loose motions with blood. No, in viral fever, because that is specific. Viral fever majority times has only one important symptom: severe debility. Patient is drawn down, lost of full energy, and fever is, of course, fever is there. And most important is body ache. In any viral fever, there is a severe body ache or the backache. Am I right? And sometimes a little bit coryza. And coryza means nasal secretions. That's it. This is the only symptom regarding the viral fever. Severe body ache, severe joint pain or severe backache with fever, but no other specific other symptoms. Am I right? Anyway, let us move further. After viral fever, I will give the symptoms and you have to say loudly what can be the cause of the fever. Patient with cold and cough. Fever, of course, every time fever will be there. So fever with cold, cold means again watery discharge, serous discharge, purulent discharge from the nose. That is also called as a coryza. So that is cold, cold Marathi sardi, and cough. To begin with dry cough and afterward productive cough, that is cough with expectoration. So these are the symptoms. So what can be the possible causes? Tell me, fever causes, what can be the causes? Be quick. This is the case of URTI or LRTI. What is the cause of fever? When there is a cough, when there is a cold, when there is a headache, whenever there is sinusitis, whenever there is a fever. Fever is always there, remember. Then all these things are regarding the respiratory tract. So it may be pharyngitis causing the fever, laryngitis causing the fever, tonsillitis causing the fever, bronchitis causing the fever. Is it clear? So this is mostly URTI is the diagnosis when there is associated symptoms of respiratory tract. Second patient. Fever is there, but this fever is not normal. 98, 99, 100. No, it is 102. That is called as a high fever. Then patient is complaining of cough and he is complaining of breathlessness. And patient is looking toxic. Patient is looking serious. Whole energy has been drawn. High fever is there. Chakka pastu angala. He is coughing a lot. And he is saying, I am breathless and drowsy. What can be the cause of fever? Loudly, come on. This is the case of pneumonia, pneumonitis. What is the difference in URTI? URTI fever is not high. It is not 102, 103, no. He is not toxic. He is normal. He is okay. All right, patient. But this second patient, looking more serious, is called as toxic. He is having some chest pain. A lot of cough is there. High fever is there. Immediately advise the chest x-ray. And you will get 100% diagnosis of pneumonic patch. Pneumonitis. That is pneumonic white patch will be there. And your bedside clinical diagnosis will be confirmed. Always remember these stages. General practitioner should able to diagnose bedside. That is called as a provisional diagnosis. And now there are a lot of investigations by which you can diagnose of fever 100%. So pneumonia can be diagnosed very well by the chest x-ray PA view. Remember this word, posteroanterior. Whenever you talk about cervical spondylosis, whenever you talk about vertebral column, whenever you talk about lumbago, whenever you talk about the fracture of the rib, bone, chest x-ray is always AP. Remember my words. When you talk about arthritis, when you talk about bone, x-ray is not PA. Only for the chest x-ray, it is PA view. Very clear, very clear. And all bone x-ray should be AP and lateral. This is the difference. Till now, I have discussed two cases of fever. One was diagnosed as a URTI, second was diagnosed as a pneumonia. Now I am giving you third. Third patient coming to you, he has again mild to moderate fever. 98, 99, 100, that's it, 101. Okay? Then very typical symptom is there. He says that I am, doctor, getting a chest pain on one side. Remember my words. Chest pain, unilateral chest pain. Fever is there. Or weakness is there. Tiredness is there. Kankan vatte mala alikade gele paas diusan madhe. Since last 5-6 days, 3-4 days, I am little bit not very properly fit. And I am getting chest pain. So please, what is the problem? And that chest pain is unilateral, number one. And pain increases during inspiration. Pain, chest pain increases during inspiration. Marathi madhe, in Marathi language, doctor mala shwas ghetana ujvi kade chamak marte. Kiwa davi kade chamak marte. Doctor, mala shwas ghaya lagla. Ghya, ghiun dakwa mala. Show me how it is happening. No, it's paining. So the patient is complaining unilateral chest pain, especially during inspiration. Then doctor should ask one leading question. One leading question. What you should ask? Whether there is any problem while sleeping on the bed at night. Whether you get any problem while sleeping at night during the, on the bed. Yeah, doctor, I can't lie on this side. For example, that patient is having the pain on the right side, okay? Right side of the chest, at the lower side. And when he says that, doctor, I cannot lie on the left side. I repeat, patient has a complaint, pain on the right side. Patient cannot lie on the opposite side. Then there may be, what can be the probable cause? 100% correct the answer given by the MD student, that is the case of dry pleurisy, or a little bit collection may be there, wet pleurisy. It is also called the pleuritis, and maximum type pleural effusion, pleuritis, or pleurisy, they are all, the main cause is tuberculosis. 98-95% the cause of pleurisy will be tuberculosis. So here also, so we are talking about the third patient having the mild to moderate fever. He may have the cough or may not have the cough, remember, because there is a gross difference in the tuberculosis. Pulmonary tuberculosis is called as open cox, because the infection can is in the parenchyma of the lung. But this is a closed infection. So that patient may have the cough or may not have the cough. So cough is not mandatory for this type of pleurisy. Remember, because when we say pleurisy, tuberculosis, then he should have the cough. No. Tuberculosis can affect any part of your body. Although the lung TB is 95%. But remaining 5% TB in the pleural cavity, TB in the skin, TB in the abdomen, TB in the bone. So all TBs are possible. And in TB, for example, bone, there will not be cough. TB abdomen and ileocecal junction, no cough will be there. So don't expect in the pleurisy, that in the pleurisy patient, if the pleural collection, if huge, then there may be pressure on the opposite side, and then there may be irritative cough, mechanical stimulating cough. But otherwise, he don't have the cough. So how we diagnose the case? He has a mild to moderate fever, one-sided unilateral chest pain, cannot lie on the opposite side while sleeping, but can lie down on the same side. Now with this all scenario, the doctor is coming towards the provisional diagnosis. Now he is suspecting the case may be of pleurisy. Simple confirmation, he has to immediately put the stethoscope Of course, we do the auscultation for each and every patient. But in this patient of the fever, auscultation is most important. Because in the dry pleurisy, you should get the pleural rub. This word is very, very important. Pleural rub will confirm your diagnosis nearly 99%. Where pleural rub you will get? Where he is complaining, the pain is there. Lightning pain. The description of pain is lightning pain while inspiration. Unilateral. And that particular part. Otherwise the chest will be normal. Suppose I am having the right at this lower end of the apex of the lung. I am having the pain. So on the left side everywhere, there will be no ras, no ronchi, nothing, nothing. Only here, when I put the bail of the stethoscope, diaphragm of the stethoscope, I will get the pleural rub. And that is because of the friction of two visceral and parietal pleura. It's a rubbing. And I always give the example of the polished paper available in our house. Or the student should practice to hear that particular sound. When we paint our house, first we rub our walls, and that is with the that polished paper. If the two pieces of the polished paper we just make a rubbing, a typical sound will come. And that typical sound of rubbing of the polished paper is very dicto of the pleural rub. So after again bedside diagnosis and provisional diagnosis, immediately refer patient for the chest X-ray, peer view or sonography. And there will be 100% you will find that again there will be opacity. Number one, opacity. But the most important finding in the pleurisy, anybody knows? Diagnostic finding of X-ray. Tell me the diagnostic finding of X-ray. We are discussing the differential diagnosis of fever. This is the third case we are discussing. What is that? He is trying somewhere, is uttering the word meniscus, my PG student. But the correct word is obliteration of costophrenic angle. Remember my words. Obliteration of costophrenic angle at that particular right lower lobe of the liver. Costophrenic angle. And what is meant by obliterated? It is destroyed. There will be no sharp angle. Costophrenic angle is totally destroyed. And that is the confirmatory diagnosis of pleurisy. We are talking about differential diagnosis of fever. First case was about the upper respiratory tract infection or the flu or the, of course, viral we have excluded because that is 95%. But then URTI we completed, then pneumonia we completed, and pleurisy we discussed. Fourth patient, fever with rigor. It will be moderate to high fever. Range will be 100, 101, 102 degrees Fahrenheit. And patient will say, I am getting severe shivering of my body. Whenever the fever comes up, I have to ask my family members to give me blanket. And without blanket, I cannot protect my body. That is called as a fever with rigor, R-I-G-O-R. Try to understand the difference in between chill and rigor. Chill means a small type of the skin and muscle contraction. Boom, apan jala manto ki maje case ashe ube raile. The thoda sa andavarti kata yene in Marathi, that is called as a chill. But rigor is literally shivering off your extremities. Like this, thar 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 manus udto. So that is called as a fever with rigor. And fever with rigor, this is the main complaint. When the patient is brought to you, he is only complaining. Then you have to ask the different questions. But whenever patient, you see this type of patient, fever with rigor, two or three possible causes should be in your mind. One, first cause is malaria. Second is urinary tract infection. And third is abscess. Don't forget, abscess. A-B-S-C-E-S-S. Less commonly known to the students. Three causes, don't forget, malaria, urinary tract infection, and abscess. Now we will see one by one. When you see the fever with rigor, the parents are complaining, family members are complaining that see, he is having severe fever and getting the rigors. you have to ask leading questions. When the fever is coming? नाही ते गेले तीन दिवस झाले त्यांना दररोज चार वाजले की थंडी वाजून येते. मराठीमध्ये काय सांगतील? गेले तीन दिवस, लास्ट थ्री डेज दिस चाइल्ड इज गेटिंग द फीवर ॲट द सेम टाइम ॲट 4 o'clock. और लास्ट 8 days ते दर 2 दिवसांनी, त्याला मध्येच काही नसते, मध्ये 2 दिवसांनी परत ताप येतोय. एव्हरी ऑल्टरनेट डे और एव्हरी आफ्टर 2 days ही इज गेटिंग द फीवर. दिस इज कॉल्ड एज अ पिरियॉडिसिटी. So periodicity of the fever is going towards the malaria. Remember, periodicity's word is very important for malaria. It is not necessary there should be a gap of 1 day or gap of 2 days or gap of 3 days. Even every day, if he is getting attack at a particular time, only particular time, maybe at 12 o'clock in the noon, maybe in the evening at 7 o'clock, maybe 4 o'clock, periodicity, then going towards the malaria. Okay, and then if it is not, then second question will be, if the patient is having, how is the urine? You must ask them, because patient may not tell you whether there is increased frequency. 3 symptoms are important, that he has to go to the toilet since last few days, he is every half an hour he is going to the toilet. Then no, he is having some trouble while doing the urination. That is called as a dysuria, painful micturition. Or that pain may be burning type. So burning micturition. त्याला उन्हाळी लागते सारखी आणि ताप आलेला आहे. So burning micturition, increased frequency or dysuria along with the fever with rigor is indicative of urinary tract infection. Now third point I have told you, that is about abscess. But remember, when there is a marathi madhe tala ami bend manto, bahutek vela te batakla yeto at the buttock region or at the leg region, wherever maybe. So if the patient is having a abscess in the body externally, the first patient will tell you about abscess itself. डॉक्टर, सी हियर आय हॅव अ लिटल बिट ट्युमर ऑर समथिंग, गाठ झालेली आणि ती दुखते, खूप दुखते, मग अंग तापलेलं दिसेल तुम्हाला. सो फीवर विल बी आयदर पॅरलल ऑर सेकंडरी टू द मेन सिम्पटम. द मेन सिम्पटम विल बी पेन ऑफ ॲप्सेस अँड देन हाय फीवर. सो इट इज व्हेरी इझी, देन दॅट फीवर इज बिकॉज ऑफ दॅट ॲप्सेस. ओनली द प्रॉब्लेम कम्स व्हेन देर इज अ इंटरनल ॲप्सेस, मे बी इन द चेस्ट, maybe in the peritoneal cavity, then it's very difficult. How you can find? Then there is no systemic other complaints, no periodicity of the fever, no burning or any urinary complaints, but still you are suspecting there may be some abscess because the high fever is there. Then of course you have to go for x-ray chest, sonography, CT scan, this and that. But that a dilemma. But these cases are very rare. Commonest will be the malaria and second will be the urinary tract infection and third will be the external abscess. Internal abscess, just right now forget about it, because we are talking about general practice, general medical practice. We are not talking about hospital cases. Okay? Now we will go further for the fever differential diagnosis. Next patient comes to you. I am sorry, just go back, because we have to confirm this provisional diagnosis. Then there are possibility of, you can ask for hemogram, malaria. Then there is a PBS, peripheral blood smear. You have to write down to the pathologist, please do the hemogram plus ESR. But don't forget, you must special request, do the PBS for MP, peripheral blood smear, special checking for the malarial parasite. Unless and until you mention that, pathologist will not do that thing, and then you will be dilemma. Of course, PBS for MP is also sometimes not found. MP is not found because there are so many conditions. You have to take the sample during the attack and this and that. But clinically, you can confirm that because there is no urinary symptoms. Second, simultaneously, you can do the urine routine examination. And if you find that there are a lot of pus cells, say for example 10, 15 or 5, even more than 5, more than 5 pus cells per HPF, high power field, is definitely UTI. Then give the urinary tract antibiotics. Remember my words. Urinary tract antibiotics when there is a UTI. UTI can be mild, moderate and severe. 10 to 15% mild. 25-30% moderate. And above 50, it's a high type of the urinary tract infection. And if both these things are not there, then there are very less chances that you are talking about fever with rigor with these conditions. Now, fever, next patient, sixth patient, fever with severe weakness, mild to moderate fever, not high fever, mild to moderate fever, but weakness is severe, and the most important symptoms are anorexia and nausea. Rather, patient will come to you not for fever, patient will come that I am doctor, and not the patient will complain, family members will bring him and they will say, see doctor, he is not eating anything. He is refusing and he is getting, he is saying, always I am getting a little bit nausea, vomiting, I don't want to eat. And then immediately you should have one diagnosis in your mind, that is called as severe extreme anorexia. What can be the probable cause for the fever? It's an infective hepatitis. Remember, severe anorexia, extreme, I am saying extreme, kaman lati iti kamala in Ayurveda. Kaman lati iti kamala. Kamala is a jaundice. Infective hepatitis by, especially I am talking about the commonest epidemic of jaundice, that is because of the viral A. I am not talking about the serum jaundice, virus B. I am talking about virus A hepatitis, infective hepatitis. So if you are suspecting this, then of course you have to ask whether he has any trip or the journey outside, he has visited or outside eating is there, pani pinyat alaka, hemuk zaleka, tamuk zaleka. And the most important, you have to look for conjunctiva in the daylight. What is the most important? You have to look bedside, conjunctiva, and check whether there is an icterus. Is there any yellow tinge in the eyes? But by chance, please try to understand, this icterus yellow tinge will not come on the first day. It may start after the second, third or fourth day. But if you are suspecting that this may be the case of the jaundice, then on the prior day, you should inform them that immediately tell me if your urine gets yellow or if you develop any yellowness in your eyes, immediately come to me. I feel that it may be the jaundice. Then that can create an impression on the patient's mind that yes, doctor has given me the warning. Doctor's skills, doctor knowledge should be conveyed to the patient. You should not keep your diagnosis in your mind. No, say that. It is possible because you are having the severe anorexia. And this anorexia is such a great, he has lost his interest in everything, even of his liking things. For example, I am a liking of, say, doing the computer work and doing the PPTs and uploading. But on that, these 2 days, I have said, no, I don't want to do anything. I am totally tired. I don't want to do anything. Even in the textual books, in the medicine, you will find they have written symptom as how much is the loss of interest? The patient lost the interest in your sex. This is mentioned in the modern medicine book. Such a anorexia is there. Such a kaman latiti kamala. But clinically, what you have in your hand, you can definitely palpate the liver. And liver tenderness is most important. Liver tenderness is most important to get a provisional diagnosis of jaundice or infective hepatitis. But we started with the anorexia and fever. Are you getting my point? We are talking about differential diagnosis of fever and we are talking about infective hepatitis A. Another thing, in addition to the liver tenderness, if you have the side lab in your medical clinic, you have a small laboratory where you can do the blood simple test, hemogram, where you can do the urine routine examination, you can go for urobilinogen. Remember, bile salt, bile pigment will come after. But at the beginning and at the end of the jaundice, urobilinogen will be present. But even if you give the idea to the patient, see, I am suspecting, I feel that this may get the some jaundice, and tomorrow or day after tomorrow we will do the blood test and the urine test. Then officially, to confirm your diagnosis, we have the instrument. That means we have the lab investigations. Urine, bile salt and bile pigment for the poor patients. Remember my words. Don't ask them serum bilirubin. Never necessary. In the jaundice patient, don't write even on the first day, do the serum bilirubin. Not necessary. Bile salt and bile pigments are enough to confirm your diagnosis. Bile salt will be present, bile pigments will be present. Okay? And then, but if at all some patients they complain that the jaundice is not reducing or they don't have coming the down with their symptom, of course you know that infective hepatitis will take nearly 3 weeks. Fever can be reduced after 3-4 days. But anorexia, nausea will continue, yellowness still further continue. Total recovery is possible only after the 3 weeks minimum. So this we must convince to the patient, and if the jaundice is not under control, then you can ask about the serum bilirubin. Because if it is too high, then there is another, what you can say, the subtypes of the jaundice. For example, it may be the obstructive jaundice. Because there are some dangers also, there are some complications also. So whenever you feel that the patient is not getting better and better, then definitely you must take the advanced test. There is no matter of money. You must ask for the direct and indirect bilirubin. And even you can ask about the serum alkaline phosphatase for obstructive jaundice. Serum alkaline phosphatase for obstructive jaundice with addition to the USG of abdomen. Ultrasonography of abdomen. My dear friends, we are talking about differential diagnosis of fever. So we have discussed URTI, then pneumonia, pleurisy, malaria, UTI, abscess and viral hepatitis. Next case, next patient. Patient is a small one, child or young chap, around the age of 12 years. And he comes to you, mild to moderate fever, but most problem is a flitting arthritis, migratory arthritis. He has a severe started joint pain. Knee joints are paining. Pelvic girdle, backache is there. Shoulder joint is paining. Elbow joint is paining. But that arthritis is a migratory. That means last 2 days before he had ankle pain and now he has started the knee pain. Again after 2 days he will come, he will say, doctor, that has gone, but now it is migrated to my shoulder. So migratory arthritis with high fever in children, it is a case of rheumatic fever. These diseases nowadays nearly outdated. But still, as a theoretical part, you should diagnose the rheumatic fever. Fever with joint pain, especially in the children, it is rheumatic fever. What leading question you can ask? What is the leading question? Whether the child has suffered 2 weeks back or 3 weeks back from URTI. त्याचा घसा दुखत होता का 8 दिवसापूर्वी? हो, ते 10 दिवसाला त्याचा टॉन्सिल झाले होते, ते आम्ही ट्रीटमेंट घेतली, पण ते बरं झालं, त्याचं नाही काय सम, हे आता त्याचा सांध्याचाच प्रॉब्लेम झालाय. ते म्हातारे काय म्हणते, सांध्याचाच प्रॉब्लेम झालाय, तिचं डायग्नोसिस असतं. तर त्यांना सांगावं लागतं, बिकॉज यू शुड नो रुमॅटिक फिवर इज अ पोस्ट स्टेप्टोकोकल इन्फेक्शन. रुमॅटिक फिवर इज अ पोस्ट स्टेप्टोकोकल इन्फेक्शन. सो देअर मस्ट बी हिस्ट्री of upper respiratory tract infection 8 or 10 days back. Am I right? This is provisional bedside diagnosis. But you have good investigation to confirm the rheumatic fever. To confirm the rheumatic fever, what test? Blood test? ASO titer. Don't forget it. Capital ASO. Anti Streptolysin O titer. Anti Streptolysin O titer. ASO titer. This is confirmatory. It is always high. more than 200, more than 100. ASO titer. This is blood exam. And this titer will be definitely high. You can confirm your diagnosis. Next case about the fever. Fever will be there. Edema of the legs. Another symptom. Edema of the legs. And inguinal lymph glands are tender. Inguinal lymph glands are tender. That is called as a lymphadenopathy. So, pitting or non-pitting edema on the leg, inguinal glands are swollen and the patient is moderate to high fever, 102, 103. This also may be with rigor. Remember, this may be the case with rigor. So, what can be the probable diagnosis? What can be the probable diagnosis? This is the case of filariasis. This is the case of filariasis. But of course, it is not common every part of the India. If that particular area like Bihar, for example, if it is prone for this filarial, then only you can diagnose in that way. This is a filariasis. But filariasis is very common in the local where the filarial infection is common. So you must find out those areas, and if you are practicing in that areas, then only you can suspect about the filariasis, fever with rigor, edema of the legs, and of course then you can examine the blood for filarial infection. There is a blood test also. Elephantiasis. The common name is elephantiasis. In Ayurveda, it is called as a shleepad or hatti rog in Marathi. Next case of differential diagnosis of fever. Patient is complaining to you mild fever, but tremendous loose motions. Acute. Since last evening, he is coming to you in the clinic in the morning. Doctor, last night, of course, the patient will not tell. Patient is so drowsy and dehydrated, he will not be able. But again, the case may be of child or maybe of the old person. That patient is brought by the family members. And he is suffering from the lot of loose motions. Frequent, nearly in the night, throughout the night, 10 to 12 times. And he is having the high fever. A very simple diagnosis. What is that diagnosis? What is that diagnosis? Loose motions with fever is a bacterial diarrhea. Simple. Bacterial diarrhea. It's an infection to the intestines. But if the case is with the vomiting, loose motion is also there, vomiting is also there, and fever is there, then what can be the case? It's both inflammation of the stomach, inflammation of the intestine. So it is a gastroenteritis. The name is very interesting. Gastro for stomach, enteritis for intestine. So this is a combined infection. So we are talking about the case of food poisoning. All of a sudden, he is getting the food poisoning and he starts with the infection, even serious infection, gastroenteritis. There will be fever plus loose motions plus vomiting. And of course, you can examine the stool examination. And in the stool, you will get the pus cells and the RBCs very clearly. Pus cells and RBCs will indicate that this is definitely 100% bacterial diarrhea. Acute. This is all acute. I am not talking about chronic diarrhea. Fever with diarrhea is a gastroenteritis or enteritis. Next patient of the fever. Fever is greater than 1 week. It is not coming down with the symptomatic treatment of Ayurveda or the modern medicine. Antipyretic, temporary the fever comes down, again it climbs up. Coming down, again it climbs up. And gradually it is increasing. First 2 days it was mild fever. 98, 99. Then again moderate, 100, 10. And in the second week it's very high. 102, 103. Remember, at the same time, in addition to that, he has a headache. He has a headache, body ache, constipation. So, fever is not controlled even in the 1 week. The second week is started of the fever. So, what can be the cause for the second week fever? the fever is continuous for 8, 9, 10 days or 7, more than 7 days, what can be the possible cause? Yes? Yes, that's right. Enteric fever or the typhoid. Very commonest cause, typhoid. Then of course, some clinical hints are there. If you always have the habit of checking the pulse of any fever patient, make it a habit. Always check the pulse. In usual case, whenever there is a rise of 1 degree fever in your body, your pulse rate will increase by 10. For example, my normal pulse rate is 80. Dr. Deshpande's normal pulse rate is 80 per minute. Now I have got the fever. And my fever normal is 898. And now I have the fever of 100. So 98 to 100, 2 degrees has been increased. So my pulse will show round about 100 also. For 1 degree Fahrenheit rise of the temperature, you will rise the pulse rate by 10. This is very normal phenomena. In every cases of fever, there will be tachycardia. Is it clear? But some fevers are there where there is a relative bradycardia. Remember my words. And this is typical of typhoid. Typhoid is called as a relative bradycardia. That means my patient's temperature chakka basto angala 103 degrees taap ahe, but pulse is only 90. How it is that possible? You should have come in mind it may be the typhoid. Temperature is very high, but pulse rate not so much high. Pulse rate, I am talking about pulse rate. It will be bounding, but pulse rate will not be so high. That is called as a relative bradycardia. Second important feature, in the first week of the fever, in typhoid there will be constipation, but in the second week there will be diarrhea. Remember my words, you have to ask the history. Every day you must ask, how is your stool, how is your bowel? Usually fever patients complain of constipation, but this typhoid fever, second week he will get the pee, soup, diarrhea. This is theoretical description, but constipation will be converted to the diarrhea. Then of course there is a 100% confirmatory diagnosis by doing the blood examination, that is Vidal test. WIDL, Vidal test is specific for typhoid. But this BUT is very important in typhoid. Nowadays, there is one important condition for doing this Vidal test. The patient should not have consumed antibiotic. This is the first condition by the pathologist. Patient should not take any antibiotic, then the real results will come. Or Vidal test may be negative and you will be happy, no typhoid. No, that is wrong. So what is the condition? There should not be antibiotic. Number one. Number two, Vidal test be positive only in the second week, after minimum 7, 8, 9 days. So on the 9th and 10th day of the fever, if you send the patient without antibiotic to the lab, then Vidal test be 100% positive. If this is a case of typhoid. So typhoid is equal to Vidal. Remember, typhoid is equal to Vidal test. Of course, it may be positive or it may be negative, but you have to do it. You have to do it for the satisfaction of the patient as well. But for the MD exam, you must remember the two conditions. When Vidal test will be positive, if the patient has not consumed any antibiotic in the first week, and second will be there, it should be done in the, not on the third day, not on the second day. What you can do for the whole first week then? The patient will be angry with you. Doctor la kai samjat nahi hai, yacha pura cha taap kami hot nahi hai, he will change the doctor. This is always possible nowadays. If your fever is not controlled within 2 days, they shift the doctor. Again, fourth day, they will shift the doctor. And then finally they will go to the consultant or in the hospital. See, now jawalcha doctor la kai kalat nahi, tyacha taapas kami hot nahi pura cha, ata kas kami kasa hoil. It's not at all a fault of general practitioner. But what is the fault? What is the fault? He has not convinced to the family members. That see, at the moment I am not, because it is always confirmed in the second week, but I feel it's not coming down with our medicine. It may be the case of typhoid. If you already said to the family members, then they have little bit faith on you. That you can tell them, we will see, don't worry. Even if your fever remains, we will control it, definitely. There will not be any problem. Patient will not be having any complication. This is my responsibility. But just keep the patience. Do the cold sponging. Repeated sponging should be there. Control the fever. I am giving you the medicine. I am giving you paracetamol. I am giving you Ayurvedic Maha Sudarshan Ganavati, which is the best one. Which is the best one. Remember my words. Remember my words. Now I am discussing nearly 18 or 20 cases of fever. But in each and every case of the fever, you can use paracetamol from the modern medicine as a symptomatic treatment of fever, that is called as an antipyretic. But better than paracetamol, remember my words, Maha Sudarshana Ganavati can be continued from the day 1 to the 30th day of the fever. See my bold statement, 30th day. Let it be tuberculosis, let it be typhoid, let it be pneumonia, let it be the gastroenteritis. Remember my word, take it from me. I am challenging for that matter. Don't afraid of giving the Maha Sudarshana Ganavati. In each and every case, it will not do any harm. It will not do any harm. If it is a URTI, see if it is a rheumatic fever, see if it is a jaundice, nothing harm will be there. Because this is called as a bitter tonic in our language. Bitter tonic, rasayana, with the tikta rasa. Kade Chiraiti is there, herb. And that Maha Sudarshana Ganavati of Baidyanath, minimum 2 tablets 3 times in a day. Minimum 2 tablets in the morning, afternoon and evening. You can give for any cases of fever. Take it from me. It will take care of the patient's health also. It will control the fever. I am not saying it is curing the typhoid. I am not saying it is curing the pneumonia. I am not saying it is curing the pleurisy. Is it that? No, I am not saying. I am saying it is the best accompanying drug to control the fever. You can give the specific tuberculosis treatment. You can give the specific meningitis treatment. You can give specific typhoid treatment. No problem. But Maha Sudarshana Ganavati can be given with your treatment, with your antibiotic. You will say, no, doctor, is very serious pneumonia. I have started the Roxid 150 milligram BD. I have started with the typhoid ciprofloxacin. I have started with gentamicin in the hospital. Remember my words. Whatever you do, but you can continue with that Maha Sudarshana Ganavati. There will not be any harm to the patient. That much confidence that Ayurvedic Vaidya should have, student should have. Next case, fever greater than 3 weeks. But in addition to that, the most important complaint is a cough. That's a khokla bara hot nahi hai. Doctor, khup ami te syrup kaadhe getle, tumcha Ayurveda che pan te vasa syrup getla, te chatan pan dila hota amala, te modern te doctor ne amala antibiotic pan khayla gatla, but yacha khoklaach bara hot nahi hai. Cough is not getting cured more than 3 weeks. First diagnosis in your mind should be TB. Remember my words. Cough. Lung tuberculosis. Cough not getting cured with antibiotic, with Ayurvedic medicines, with satana, with vasa syrup. First thing, it may be the tuberculosis. But in addition to that, you can ask the leading question. Leading questions are very important. How is your appetite? TB, anorexia will be there. Nahi doctor, te alikade jale 2 mahine kay mala farsa bhook nahi lagat. Main khato mi pan te kay asa kha manapasun nahi vatat. But what about your weight? Ha te thoda kami jale maza weight. Ha he thoda kami jale. He may not be specific. Some another patient will say, doctor, yanche vajan khup kami jale cha. काय कळत नाही त्याचे खोकला तक्रार नसेल. ही मे हॅव द कंप्लेंट ऑफ वेट लॉस. दिस इज अनदर क्रायटेरिया फॉर डायग्नोसिंग ट्युबरक्युलोसिस. फीवर इज नॉट प्रिडॉमिनंट. ट्राय टू अंडरस्टँड, इन ट्युबरक्युलोसिस, लंग ट्युबरक्युलोसिस, फीवर मे नॉट बी मॉडरेट अँड हाय, रादर इट इज ऑलवेज माइल्ड. 100% मराठी शब्द लक्षात ठेवा. यांच्या अंगात ते हाडीताप भरलाय, त्याच्या अंगाला कणकण वाटते सारखी. Even patient don't understand that he has a fever. But this patient definitely has a fever, which is called as evening rise of temperature. Vyadhi pratyanika lakshan, pratyatma lakshan. Evening rise of temperature is a peculiarity of TB. And that is unnoticed by the patient and the family members. They don't, because they don't have any, like, no. Then how you will confirm? How you will confirm? If you want to clinically confirm, how you can confirm? You can just ask him, if the patient is little bit educated, of middle family, ask him to buy the thermometer from the pharmacy and note the 8 a.m. and 8 p.m. temperature. If any of your family member is suffering from weakness, anorexia, first check the temperature, 8 a.m., 8 p.m., morning and evening. So you will find definitely there is a difference of 1 degrees or 1.5 degrees Fahrenheit in the morning and evening. In the morning 97, in the evening 98. In the morning 97.5, in the evening 99. So this type of the changes, morning and evening. Evening temperature will be always high, that is called as a evening rise of temperature. But this is not like malaria, this is not like UTI. Patient will not complain fever with rigor, fever with chill, no. Only he will complain weakness, tremendous weakness, weight loss, anorexia, and sometimes not controlled cough. Then your diagnosis should be tuberculosis. Even in the auscultation, it is very difficult to diagnose the case of TB. If it is really, really big cavity, tubercular cavity, then it is a bronchial sound. But again, it can be missed. It can be missed because tubercular infection, in the beginning at least, is not all over the chest. Try to understand. Tubercular infection is always at the apex. Here, clavicle, at the apex of the lung and not at the bottom. Pleurisy is at the bottom, starting. But TB, upper pole of the lung. And many times, many doctors, they always keep the stethoscope on the lower part or the middle lobe of the liver or the lower lobe of the liver, and you will miss the bronchial sound of the cavity or what is called as a aphor, what is that typical word is there, phonetic sound is there, tubercular sound. But then only the thing in your hand is a chest X-ray PA view, and that can give the 100% diagnosis of tuberculosis, number one. And second, don't forget, if it is a excessive sputum, excessive cough is there, sputum for AFB is a must. Sputum for acidophaste bacilli, AFB, acidophaste bacilli, AFB. Here also very interesting, sputum examination should be done minimum for 3 days, don't forget, minimum for 3 days, and patient should be trained to give the sample, because many times they give only saliva. Te thuktat tya batli madhe patient, nuste thuktat, thukun upyogach nahi hai. It should have the cough coming from the respiratory tract, phlegm. Ta tyanna te samjun sangav lagto. The patient should be trained how to give the cough, and then there will be positive, your acidophaste bacilli will be. And why it is necessary? Because the treatment differs. Newly patient with sputum positive, treatment is different. Newly patient, sputum negative, treatment will be different. I am not going into detail. But that's why the... And third important is a hemogram ESR. Now again remember, ESR is not diagnostic. ESR is a prognostic. That means it will guide you whether my AKT, whether doctor's AKT, anti-COX treatment, anti-tubercular treatment, is going on well or not. Of course, the patient will reduce the fever, weakness will be reduced, cough will be reduced. But if you want objective parameter, yes, this patient is really improving. So in spite of believing on the patient, do the ESR. To begin with, it will be 80 millimeter at the end of 1 hour. Something high, 80, 70, 100, 60. Normal is up to 20 ml. Then it will gradually come down and it will settle down at the 20 mm of Hg. So ESR is also one of the important. Next patient of the fever. Fever is there for more than 3 weeks, but there is no cough. All other symptoms are there, but no cough is there. Then I have already explained you that may be the case of TB, extra pulmonary TB, that is called as a extra pulmonary TB. Extra means not extra, outside the lungs. And these places, as I have explained you, the commonest places are the POTS disease. POTS, POTS disease. That is tubercular arthritis in the vertebral column. Your vertebrae are affected, especially lumbosacral region. This place is very common. In tuberculosis patient, you must examine the lymph glands, cervical lymph glands, axillary lymph glands, inguinal lymph glands, because in the abdominal TB, which is common at the ileocecal junction, you get the inguinal lymph glands increased. So you have to find out whether the other parts of the body has been affected. Next case of the fever is a fever with rash. Fever with rash. So fever with rash, common is the children, measles and chicken pox and herpes zoster. Measles, chicken pox and herpes zoster, this is a differential diagnosis for fever with skin rash. Maculopapular, vesicular, bullous, I am not going into detail, but rash is there in spite of the other symptoms of measles. Govar congenia in Marathi. So whenever the child is coming to you, you must have the diagnosis like measles, chicken pox, and in the adult it may be the herpes zoster. Okay, so you have to find out any rash on the neck and back. Fever with severe pain in the long bones, history of mosquito bite or endemic or epidemic area with the mosquito exposure, and fever with, this may be again with rigor, try to understand, this may be again rigor, very bad headache, severe headache is there. Usually in any cases of the fever, I will suggest even general practitioner should at least do the hemogram on the second day. Do routinely hemogram, blood count, RBCs, hemoglobin, WBCs. Especially in these cases, what can be the diagnosis? It is called as a break bone fever. Break bone fever. Very severe pain in the body. Not like viral fever, even more than that. And fever is high. Fever is high. 102, 103. Acute fever is coming up. So what can be the diagnosis? Dengue is the commonest possibility. And confirmation is by platelet count. Platelet count, if it is on the lower side, it is going favored towards the dengue or the chikungunya. Chikungunya is another same infection by the mosquitoes, viral infection. But the difference is, in chikungunya, in spite of the long bones, the joints are affected. Remember, chikungunya, both are acute. Chikungunya fever is little bit less than the dengue. Dengue is 102, 103, 104. But the chikungunya, it may be 100, 101. But the most important, all of a sudden, bony joints are stiff. Patient cannot move. It's like a locked joints, L-O-C-K-E-D, locked joints. So when the typical joints are locked, some cases I have seen that all of a sudden he has gone to the toilet for the stools and he cannot get up. Such a pain has been started, acutely started, without any history of, he is not a old patient, he is not an osteoarthritic patient, he is not a rheumatoid arthritic patient. Acutely joint pains has been started, and after 1 or 2 hours he has started the fever also, and then coming to the doctor, then he, with the joint pain, especially with the fever, this is going towards the chikungunya. And there is also the platelet count is low, but the bleeding tendency is common in the dengue than the chikungunya. Remember, bleeding tendency, danger is more to the dengue than the chikungunya. The danger of chikungunya is, what is the danger? In Ayurvedic it is called as udarka. Udarka, in modern it is called as sequelae. Sequelae is a problem. For example, dengue, whatever it may be, serious hemorrhagic dengue or without hemorrhagic dengue, it can be controlled under the 8 days, 10 days, 15 days, that's it, finish. Everything is alright. No other problem. But chikungunya, fever go, joint pain little bit reduced, but his weakness and debility in the joint or intermittent pain continues for 3 months, 6 months, even 1 year, even 2 year. This is the case of the chikungunya. So problem is chikungunya with the after effects. They are very, very bad. So after sequelae is very bad. Then next, maybe the last one or coming towards the end. High fever, jaundice is there, icterus is there, yellow sclera is there, and bleeding from the gum, bleeding from the nose, bleeding from the urine. That is called as hemorrhagic tendency. High fever is there, 102, 103, 104, high fever. Okay? No bone pain, no joint pain, but jaundice is there, bleeding is there, and the rainy season is there. Another criteria is a rainy season. And the patient is from the little bit slum area. So what can be the possibility? It is leptospirosis. Comparatively very rare. It is not common like dengue and chikungunya. They are on the top. Swine flu, dengue, chikungunya, on the top. But if you are practicing in Bombay, practicing in, for example, Kerala, nowadays they, you have heard about flood. So this is always caused because of the rat bite. Remember, rat bite. Or rather, it's not actually the rat bite, I'm sorry, but it is because of the urine. That urine of the rat is excreting this particular spirochetes. Spirochete, the cause is the spirochetes, typical organism for the leptospirosis, and it is excreted through the urine of the rat. And that is mixed in the rainy water. And when the people are working, some people, for example, miners are there, or the sewage workers are there, which are working with the pit holes. आपण म्हणतो ना ते रस्त्यावरचे जे कॉर्पोरेशनचे लोक असतात की ज्यांना ते सगळं संडास मैला वगैरे साफ करायचा असतो ते खाली ड्रेनेजमध्ये उतरतात तर त्या लोकांना जे जे बेअरफूटवाले आहेत इवन कोकणामध्ये गेलात तुम्ही तर राईस वॉटर राईस फार्मिंग ज्यांचं आहे ते सुद्धा त्या स्त्रियांनी किंवा यांनी आपण अनवाणी काम केलं बेअरफूट काम केलं आणि तुमच्या पायाला कुठे जखम असली तर दॅट ऑर्गॅनिझम एंटर्स थ्रू युअर वुंड रिमेंबर सो दिस इज व्हेरी रेअर बट लेप्टोस्पायरोसिस इज वन ऑफ द इम्पॉर्टंट कॉज Okay, and the last but not least, the emergency, which can be the fatal, this type of the fever. Very high fever, acute, severe maddening headache. So whenever severe headache is there, vomiting is there, and high fever is there, children. Rather, I will suggest here, for the clinical, your examination point of view, in each case of fever, remember my words. In each case of fever, make a habit to check the neck rigidity. Remember, in every case of the fever, I know it is a URTI. So I know it is infective hepatitis. But unless and until you have the confidence, better way, always check the, especially fever with headache. And if you don't check the neck rigidity, you are the culprit. Tumhi doshi ahat. You must be under prison. Why? Because that much is a seriousness. High fever with neck rigidity with projectile vomiting and Babinskin sign positive. You must check the superficial plantar reflex. Superficial plantar reflex, which is called as Babinskin sign. It is done on the plantar aspect of your foot. You have to use your clinical hammer, blunt end, from the lower part of your toe to the upper part to your fingers. Normally the finger should be contracted. But if it is positive, it is a fanning of the fever. Fingers, fanning. That is called as a Babinskin sign. Very important. And this may be the case of meningitis and it should be immediately referred to the hospital. If you make a slightest delay, that can damage his many brain parts. Or even sometimes the patient can die because it is requiring very high ICU type of treatment, higher antibiotics. So meningitis diagnosis should not be missed by the general practitioner. And how it cannot be missed? Whenever the cases of fever with headache, neck rigidity and Babinskin sign should be examined. I am not going into detail of the investigations. For example, the CFS is the commonest examination. Cerebrospinal fluid, but that will be done by the hospital. Second referred case I have mentioned is a dengue. Remember, hemorrhagic dengue is such a fatal disease. So whenever you diagnose or suspect by your investigation, blood thrombocytopenia is there, platelet count is going down below the 1 lakh, below 50,000, immediately admit without wait, because the dengue patient will require a lot of IV fluids and fresh blood transfusion. Otherwise, patient will die. So in these all GP cases, some cases you must remember where to admit. Third case, gastroenteritis, is actually the normal. No problem. GP can treat. Especially if he has a daycare, 100% he can treat. But if you feel gastroenteritis, loose motion, vomiting, high fever, and patient is becoming drowsy, he stopped urine passing, and third degree dehydration. Second or third degree dehydration, immediately admit, because he will require the IV fluids. So you must have the idea which patient should be admitted. Especially pneumonia. If the patient having a very small, less than 7 years of age and more than 70 years of age, remember my words, extreme of age, and don't take the risk. Because, why? Because that is not a lobar pneumonia. That is not a lobar pneumonia. It is a bronchopneumonia. It is a subtype of pneumonia. Remember my words. Pneumonia can be diagnosed. Pneumonia 100% can be treated by general practitioner. But which in the adult? Age 30, 35, 40, 45, healthy. And you see in the X-ray only one small patch is there. That can be treated. But both the lungs are affected. Then that is called as a bronchopneumonia, and it is very common in the children and in the old age, below 7 and after 70. So amongst all these parameters, you must be able, where you are, the case is not under your control, it has to be shifted to the hospital. But I personally feel in this today's lecture of Wednesday, that is of 5th of September 2019, I am very much given you the confidence how to make the differential diagnosis of commonest symptom in our general practice, that is the jwara or the fever. So I just make a fast only names. First, we have said 90% is a viral fever. Second, we discussed upper respiratory tract infection, pharyngitis, bronchitis, then pneumonia, then pleurisy, then malaria, then UTI, then infective viral hepatitis A, rheumatic fever, filarial or elephantiasis, bacillary dysentery, typhoid, tuberculosis, meningitis, TB outside the lungs, measles, chickenpox, herpes zoster, swine flu, dengue, and last was the leptospirosis. Is that clear? So thank you very much for patience hearing, and request all of you to share my YouTube channel. Thank you.